Hello students, today in this video we are going to see about what are the methods available for dewatering. So before that, first we will see what is mean by dewatering, right? So in the case of foundation excavation, if there is any water leakage, then it is very necessary to remove that. Otherwise, if we construct anything, any concreting work or masonry work, if we construct, so there we will face so many problems and we will have a weak structure. Okay, so to avoid this, we have to remove the water present in that foundation excavation. Okay, so the action of removing water from the foundation is called dewatering. So de means removal, so removal of water, okay, from the foundation excavation. So next is, what is the necessity? Ease of concreting or masonry in foundation, to protect concrete or masonry from the effects of water, to prevent soil erosion around the base pit. And in which situation we can prefer this dewatering, especially in case of deep excavation and in waterlogged areas, then in docks and harbors, then in for pile foundation. So we have some methods for dewatering. So we'll see one by one. First one is open sump and ditches, a well point system, a deep well system, electro osmosis method, ground freezing method. The last one is the grouting method. The first one is open sump and ditches. So where we have a accumulation of water, so there we'll construct a small sump and the pump is connected with that, so that the water collected in the sump and it is pumped by means of a pump. So this is the normal method. So the essential feature of this method is a sump below the ground level of the excavation at one or more corners or sides. A small dish is cut around the bottom of the excavation falling towards the sump. It is the most widely used and economical of all methods of groundwater lowering. In this method of dewatering, water is disposed by adjusting the pump of the trench. So usually centrifugal pump are generally more useful. And this method is used for shallow bases in waterlogged areas. In this way, ditches are dug on both sides of the trench. The ditches size is usually 20 cm in dia of a semicircle. And the sums are made at a distance of 40 meter to 60 meter in the ditches. The size of the sums is kept as 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter. The water flows into the ditches and collects in the sums. Then water is pumped out from the sums continuously. The next method is the well point system. So well point system is nothing but a typical well point system consists of a series of small diameter tubes. So the small diameter tubes are called as a well points. So with the slots near the bottom that are inserted into the ground and connected through a header pipe. And the pipe, the pump creates a vacuum in the header pipe, drawing water out of the ground. So here we can see well point system. So here we have a series of well points. Well point is nothing but a small diameter tubes. Okay, in the small diameter tubes, at the bottom we can see a slot, or we can say a filter, which the slot is having a filter. So this filter, it will filter or it will screen any other coarse materials or any dust, any other debris entering into the well points. Okay, and all these well points are connected by this horizontal header pipe. Okay, and a pump is connected with the header pipe, and this pump, it will create a vacuum in the header pipe and it draws the water out of the ground. Okay, so this is the well point system. So we have a series of well points, and these well points are connected with the header pipe. This header pipe is connected with the pump. So this pump will draw all the water from the well points. So here we can see, so at the bottom of the well point we have a filter. So we have a screen in that. So it will makes the debris not to enter into the well points. And this is one more type, multi-stage well point system. So here have different stages, step by step. Okay, so at each step we have a rows of well points, and we have all these are connected with a header pipe, and a separate pump is provided. And the next stage also we have a rows of well points, and it is again connected with a header pipe. Then we have a separate pump. So here the site we can see, here also we can see. here. The water is dewatered here using this well point system. Here also we can see. The next is the deep well methods. Okay, the before method we have seen is only for shallow depth, and for deeper depth we have to go for a deep wells. So a deep well system uses a bored well, typically pumped by a submersible pump. Effectively, this method involves applying the drilling and pumping technologies used in water supply wells and using them in dewatering system. An array of bored wells pumped by submersible pump. Pumping from each well lowers the groundwater level and creates a cone of depression or drawdown around itself. Okay. So this is they are drilling the bore well. So if you go for a deeper depth, then we have to go for this deep wells. So it is available with the different materials like stainless steel, galvanized low carbon steel. Then we have a perforated pipe. And here this is the ordinary pump, okay, what we can see in our houses. So the below that, above the ground level, we can see this pump system, and below that we have this deep well system. The next method is electroosmosis method. So here the current is made to flow between anode to cathode. So this method is used for fine grained cohesive soil such as clay, which can be drained or stabilized using electric current. And this method was developed by L. Casagrande in 1952. If direct current is passed between two electrodes driven into natural soil moss, then the water will travel from the positive electrode, that is the anode, to the negative electrode, that is the cathode. The cathode is usually made in the form of well point or a metal tube for pumping out the seeping form, or well point or a metal tube for pumping out the seeping water. A steel rod, a pipe or steel piling of excavation can serve as the cathode. This arrangement of electrode is done in such a way that the natural direction of flow of water is reversed away from the excavation, thereby increasing the strength of the soil and stability of the slope. So here we can see, so we have a cathode and anode. So this anodes are nothing but we have some steel pipes, or usually we can have sheet pile walls. Okay, so that is, and the cathode is serve as a small well points having a perforated perforations in that. So then a current is passed between this cathode and anode, so that the water flows from the sheet piles towards this cathode point, that is the well points. Okay. This is the electroosmosis method. The next method is the ground freezing method. So here there is a change in water into the soil into a solid wall of ice which is completely impermeable. So here they are changing the soil water into a solid wall of ice which is impermeable. So artificial ground freezing is a technique that converts in-situ pore water to ice through the circulation of chilled liquid via a system of small diameter pipe placed in drilled holes. Artificial ground freezing is a construction technique that is used in the construction of shaft, mines and tunnels to provide temporary earth support and groundwater control when other conventional methods such as dewatering, shoring and grouting or soil mixing do not feasible. And this soil freezing is a technique for temporary soil reinforcement by creating an ice soil structure in the ground. The concept is to convert pure water into ice. Freezing is obtained by circulation of liquid nitrogen or brine in closed pipe placed in the ground, or by a combination of both methods. Frozen ground may be used to create solid, load resistant and watertight structure for tunneling work, cross passages between tunnels, pits and shaft excavation, and TBM, that is tunnel boring machine break-in or rescue. So usually there are two methods available for soil freezing. The direct method is freezing with liquid nitrogen, and this method takes a short freezing time but it has high energy and maintenance cost. The indirect method is with liquid brine, which offers low energy and maintenance cost. It takes around 20 to 30 days for freezing the ground, but this method is also suitable for confined spaces. The so-called mixed method is a combination of freezing with liquid nitrogen and brine. The first method, direct method, is nitrogen is maintained in a liquid state in an isolated tank slightly above the atmospheric pressure. At a temperature of minus 196 degree, the fluid circulates in copper pipes installed in the ground and freezes the soil around the pipe, and the exhausted gas is released into the atmosphere. So a liquid nitrogen is passed having a temperature of minus 196 degree through a copper pipe. Okay, so and this it will freezes the water in the ground, ground. So the exhausted gases are released into the atmosphere. Under normal conditions, freezing of a soil body is completed within 5 to 8 days. A system of temperature measuring points allows for monitoring of the freezing process and optimization of nitrogen consumption. The second method is brine is a nearly 30% solution of calcium chloride in water. So this is circulated into the ground inside low carbon steel pipes, forming a closed circuit between the pipes and the freezing plant. And it circulates at a temperature of approximately minus 35 to minus 38 degree under normal condition, and the freezing takes place within 20 to 30 days. And here also a monitoring system is provided. And the last one is the so-called mixed method, uses both the liquid nitrogen for the freezing phase and the brine for the maintenance phase. So it saves times for the freezing phase compared to the brine method. On the other hand, it can be quite expensive since it requires the installation of a separate distribution system for both brine and liquid nitrogen and the use of copper pipe inside the steel freezing pipe. After the nitrogen freezing phase, the temperature of the copper pipes needs to be above minus 35 degree for the liquid brine to circulate, otherwise the brine could freeze into the pipes. The last method is the grouting method. So grouting is nothing but it consists of injecting a fluid material at a certain pressure into the soil or rock in order to decrease the permeability or strengthen the formation. So grouting in civil engineering refers to injection of pumpable material into the soil or rock formation to change its physical characteristics. It is one of the way groundwater can be controlled during engineering works. The process of grouting consists of filling pores or cavities in soil with a liquid form material to decrease the permeability and improve the shear strength by increasing the cohesion when it is stripped. So grouting is nothing but filling a consists of filling pores or the cavity in the soil with a liquid form. That usually you'll be using cement mortars, so that it will decrease the permeability and increase the strength of the soil. So cement-based grout mixes are commonly used for gravelly layers or fissure rock treatment. Grout is usually a mixture of cement, sand and water or some chemicals that are used to fill gaps. They are used in repairing concrete cracks, filling seams and gap in tiles, gaps for sealing and waterproofing, and for soil stabilization. So thank you.